I've seen here Invest Era Plus Africa, that they've chosen to come to Africa to promote investment in the African continent. As you know, I am the African Union High Representative on Infrastructure Development. What does that mean? My responsibility is to act as a catalyst in promoting infrastructure development on the continent of Africa. As you know, infrastructure is very crucial to any development. About 10 years ago, when I was launching a campaign, I said one way of solving our problem, number one, is infrastructure. Number two, infrastructure. Number three, infrastructure. Because infrastructure helps to open up the country for investment and development. The African Union has now created the African Continental Free Area, Free Trade Area, creating the biggest free trade area zone in the world. Because that creates a market of 1.3 billion people. But how does Africa become a one market without infrastructure? For now, Africa trades very little with itself. Look at the statistics on international trade. Europe, inter-European trade stands at 70%. Intra-Asian trade stands at 50%. But intra-African trade stands at 15%, lower than even South America, which is at 25%. One of the biggest impediments to trade on the continent of Africa is lack of infrastructure. I give an example. There's a country called Central African Republic. It's just stones through away from Kenya. Between us and Central African Republic is only South Sudan. But how do we trade there? If you want to send Kenyan tea or coffee to Central African Republic, you have to put it, pack it, and put it in a find a ship first, which will go around the Cape and then run along the western coast up the Cameroonian port of Douala or Kribi, and then put it on a truck all the way up to Central African Republic. The Europeans are faster there than you from Kenya. That's why in Central African Republic they drink Kenyan coffee, Kenyan tea, and it's called British breakfast tea. Because you can't reach it. And that is why I'm fighting very hard to fast track some of this intercontinental infrastructure development, like intercontinental highways, intercontinental railway lines, the ICT link, the fiber optic network across the continent, the promotion of open space, open airspace, so that planes can fly from different parts of the continent without having to pay so much fees, which make air transport too expensive on the continent. So technology is important, and we need to promote particularly the ICT. When I was at the university, our professor used to tell us that there is an information superhighway that is coming, which is going to revolutionize the world, and is going to make the world a global village. He was talking and he was thinking he was just joking. Now the ICT has come and has miniaturized the world. The world is now so small. Communications so fast. You do something here within 2 minutes of me, it is in California. Somebody is calling you from Australia. Oh, we saw what you said at the Serena Hotel in Nairobi a few minutes ago. So the world has become a truly global village. But how does Africa benefit from this? I don't want us to repeat the mistakes that we've made in the past. As Jimmy has told you, when we got independent, the new government came up first with a policy called Africanization. Because the colonial government had practiced apartheid in our country. People were segregated along racial lines. There were Wazungus, number one, the white, then the Asian, Mhindi, then the Marabu, then the African. So African was deliberately excluded from serious economic activities in the country. If you are found with 100 shillings notes, you'll be arrested. Maybe up. So the first phase of our development, characterized by deliberately trying to promote the local people, it was called Africanization. Later on, there were complaints that that was discriminating other communities. So it was called Kenyanization. And there were certain areas you could not get involved unless you were a Kenyan citizen. The Kenyan citizenship, as you know, was created in 1963. Before 1963, there was nothing like Kenya as a country. When a Kenya colony. So all of us who were born before that time were all British citizens. When I became Kenyan citizens, at that time I was actually abroad. I became a Kenyan citizen when I was abroad. I traveled abroad as a Tanzanian. A Tanganyikan, actually. I had a Tanganyikan passport for 3 years. That's why they welcomed me so much when I go to Tanzania.